Yes, thank you, Marcia. Hello to everybody. Today we are going to present, indeed, as Mars told already, how to use design in Diana for a slab spanning over three spans. Today we are going to talk about a slab. A slab, as you can see here, just as an example. How to approach the design, do a checking of your design, and also how to perform a full nonlinear analysis on that design you made. The example model is very easy, but you can also expand it to any structure you would like. The first session will be about the design phase. We will try to calculate the required amount of reinforcement based on your model geometry and your loads on it. And then for the second part, we will choose, based on the required amount of reinforcement, choose a reinforcement grid and or bars. And then we calculate the unity checks on the SLS crack width deflection. And for the ULS, you could check your bending moments and your shear forces. And then an advanced feature that not a lot of other programs do have is our nonlinear approach, of course, where we can test the robustness of the design and see the real failure after you load it onto more load than the design. So this first session is about getting the required reinforcements. And for that, we need a reinforcement grid, basically at the top and the bottom of the slab, where you would like to know your required reinforcement. So you will have to put two grids, as they are called in Diana, in your slab. And then based on the bending moments and the cross-section forces, Diana will calculate the amount of reinforcement needed for the tensile capacity, and it will take the compression zone for the concrete itself. Of course, we will need the assumption of a certain level arm between the compression and the tension side of the concrete in this phase. So it's a preliminary design, and then normally you take something around 0.9 of your height of the structure. And your equivalent, your required reinforcement is calculated as an equivalent thickness of the grid. And I explain here how that can be interpreted. As for example, you would like to add reinforcements of 10 bars, 10 with a core-to-core spacing of 150 millimeter. And then in SI units, in meters, you have an equivalent thickness of 0.524 exponent minus 3 square meter per meter. That would be the same as 0.524 square millimeter per millimeter. And that is also the same as about half a millimeter of a plate steel. So the output of Diana will always be in the equivalent thickness. And you can back calculate it yourself to a certain bar and sizing of the core to core distance. The assumptions during this first preliminary design phase is that only the reinforcement steel supports tension forces. So there are, in basic, no tension forces in the concrete, and the concrete only supports compressive forces. In this phase, only linear stress distribution is used. So on your model, there will be a load, and based on that load, the bending moments and shear forces will be calculated. And therefore, damage in the concrete, redistribution of stresses because of that will be neglected and not taken into account in this phase. It will be taken into account in a later phase. Reinforcement can be added in two directions. In this case, it will be to the global X and global Y direction, but you can also set it for a skew bridge, for instance, in another direction. As long they don't need to be perpendicular to each other, and you can make your own direction in the YANA if needed. And as I already mentioned, we need on each side of the slab one design reinforcement grid that will be evaluated. And based on the output of the cross-sectional forces, we will get the combined reinforcement forces. So, of course, we have the normal force and the bending moment. From that, we get the reinforcement force in the X direction, the Y direction, and of course also the torsional. And we need to combine them. We do that for the reinforcement on top, above the neutral plane, and on bottom, below the neutral plane. And based on that, we can calculate the AS required based on the normal reinforcement force in the X direction and the absolute value of the torsional. And we divide that by the yield stress of the steel. As I already mentioned, the level arm between the upper, between the reinforcement and the other side of the concrete, and the bottom reinforcement and the upper side of the concrete, is basically HT minus the cover times the level. Let's say normally 0.9 times the age of the structure, the height of the structure. What is the workflow in design? Basic workflow is first you have to set up your geometry, of course. We define the geometry. I will show that later in the example. Then we add the reinforcement grids. We assign the materials to the reinforcement and the geometrical properties. In this first phase, it's just adding the checking of the AS required. Then we generate the mesh and we set up the design analysis. The design analysis is very easy now in 10.4 because all the definition of the load combination and the envelopes will be done automatically by default. I will show that also in the example. After that, we can define the output we needed, just in this case, the required reinforcement. We run the analysis and we can check the result. So for the reinforcement, we will need to give a certain stiffness, of course, and the yield stress to determine the required reinforcement. Also, we can apply the material safety factors. And on the yield stress, normally it's 1.15. And for the Young's modulus, we took just one. But you can also change it based on future versions of your code or the model code. We will have a material at the bottom, a geometry, and they are both embedded. So you don't have to give in necessarily in this phase some actual values of a bar diameter or spacing, because the YANA will calculate the required necessary area, which you can do. And if you do, you will see the ratio between your input and the required value. It's always good habit to add in your geometry section of your YANA shapes your reinforcement, your x-axis. And the x-axis, normally the local x-axis, we normally align with the global x-axis. That is only necessary when you look at local element results, and in this case we will do. In another tutorial, a lot is explained about the anchorage length. We can even take into account the anchorage length now in a linear analysis. But we will not show that in this session. And then for this phase of the required reinforcement, we need that level arm, in this case, 0.9 times the h, the height of the structure. Then we will set up the analysis by making an analysis, adding the comment, checking design, and it is added. We can manually define all the load combinations, or we can let Diana do that. And you can always rename your load combinations, your menu names, for instance, to an SLS or an ULS or a load name, what you want. In the combinations, you can set the type, for instance, serviceability limit state or the ultimate limit state, and you can give representativity factors to the different loads. In this case, we will add check on normative loading in our analysis, and then Diana will set up the full combinations automatically. So if we added that check on normative loading, we come in a pop-up screen, and there we see all the loads that are given to the model. I will show them in a minute in Diana itself. But basically, in this model, we have the dead weight of the slab, and we have three spans. So we have a load on the first span, the second span, and the third span. And in this case, it's a permanent dead weight and variable dominant loads for the other spans. With all representativity factors of one, that means they all can be on or off on the different spans. In this case, we don't have traffic load sets. That will be in another e-learning session by the end of this month. But we would like to have a combination of envelopes. And for the permanent loads, we can have a favorable action or an unfavorable action. And according to the Eurocode, for the favorable action, we need to reduce the load. And for the unfavorable action, we can increase it. Depending on your limit state, you can set the load factors of your different loads as you desire. Come to that later as well. So, if you would define all the load combination and envelopes manually, you will end up with something like this, where the first load combination is only dead weight. The second is dead weight plus the Q load on span one, etc., etc. And then you have all your load combination. It's just to show what Diana is doing underwater. And then based on this combination, Diana will make four envelopes. It will make the envelopes over the NRXX plus. That means the reinforcement force in the X direction on the top of the slab in this side, in the Y direction on the top, in the X direction on the bottom, and the Y direction on the bottom. And what does the envelope do? Let's go to this picture. We see the gray line and the black line. Let's say that's the output of some load combination. That can be combination X and combination Y, for instance. And the envelope of a maximum output, because it can be a maximum or a minimum, of course. So the plus will be a maximum, will scan over the your model structure, so span one, span two, span three, etc. It will go scan over your model and look for the most maximum result and put that in one envelope. In this way, all the other envelopes are also made. Then in Diana, you can also average results. In this example, it's not really needed because we have a line support between the spans. So the bending moments and shear forces because of the Q loads will be equal along the Y direction, along the width of the slab. But when you have a point support or another geometry that is not orthogonal, you can have a differentiation in your bending moments over the width of your structure, and then you can spread your moments and shear forces. And in Diana, the default factor for spreading is 2 for the moments, 2 times the h, and 4 times the depth of your slab for the shear forces. And we only average perpendicular to the output of the item we're looking at. So for instance, if we're looking at the shear forces Qxz, so shear forces in the x direction, let's say, then it's averaged in the y direction over the length for the shear force 4 times the depth. Then we have to define the output results, and in this case we only have to define the required reinforcement, because that is what we would like in this phase. But we also can add the applied reinforcement if we have, and then Diana can calculate the ratio of the required over the applied. The others come later in the second phase. So now we will go to Diana and show you this model. The model is taken as 5 meters of width with 3 spans of 10 meter, and it is loaded with a UDL load of 10 kilonewton per square meter on every section. So we have section 1, 2 and 3. And the thickness of the plate we have taken here as 0.5 meter. So I will stop my presentation. You can still see my screen and see the model now, I hope. If you have any questions about this first phase of how and what we are doing, please ask your questions in the question box. So this is the model. We have made the 3 sections. You can do that by adding a polygon sheet. The polygon sheet is already shown in the plane you are working in. So in this case, it's the XY plane. And you just have to set the size to 10.5 to get your first span. And if you would create it, you have your first span. We will not do that, of course, now. When you have your first span, you can select it and then array copy it in the x direction over 10 meter then as an offset. And we don't want to have that once, but we would like to have that twice. And if we would apply, we have the 3 spans. So it's very intuitive and easy to make such a model in Diana. Then we have to select the 3 shapes, and we can add the properties. Select the 3 spans, add the property, in this case a regular curved shell, and we have to add materials. I did that already. I can show the material we added. It's the concrete. Added material. And here we used a Eurocoat concrete based on a C3037. And a tensile behavior that's just brittle, so no. I will put it on SI units. Basically no after peak failure, because we don't need that in this phase. Also compression according to the Eurocode, and we don't really need it. Further. For the reinforcement, We go to the reinforcement. I will show them how to make the reinforcement. It's also intuitive and easy. Via this button, you can make reinforcement material and grid, and you can add shapes to it. So we have a bottom reinforcement that has a type grid. That's this one at the bottom. We have to give it a Young's mollus and a yield stress for the design phase. Also, we have to apply material safety factors. So if you would have a yield stress of 500 MPa, which we can show like this, and we have a safety factor of 1.50, we end up with a yield stress of 435. Put the units back on SI. The geometry. We need to add the checkbox reinforcement grid considered in design. That means Diana will evaluate the necessary forces in this part and take the AS required based on that. Indeed, we have filled in some numbers of bars and core-to-core spacing, so Diana can also output then the ratio of required about over applied. And we have added the reinforcement x-axis. So that's all for the reinforcement. Then we can go to the supports. We close this one. We need some supports, of course. We can do that in one support where we have all the x, all the z boundaries. So these four lines of the spans. I will turn off the reinforcement shapes, then you can better see it. The three supported edges lines are selected and we support them in Z direction. Then the ones in X, because of the rigid body movements, we have these two vertices selected for the X. And then we need one more for the I. Well, we took two, that's also possible, one and two for the Y direction. And then we supported all the rigid body movements. Then the loads. We have four loads. So the dead weight, you can add dead weight by just add the global load. And then you will see the dead weight you can choose. And you can add loads for the load on the spans. If I show the first one, you just have to select distributed force, select the face of the span, the load, in this case 10 kN per square meter, and the direction. So now we have set up the full model. We forgot one thing, and that is the shapes, the size of the elements. And we do that with mesh properties. The size of the elements, in this case, are set to a desired size of 0.25. Then we can mesh. I did already. And we come up with this mesh. I will turn off the reinforcement first. We show the slab here with the desired element size. And we can also look at the real cross section, the real height of the structure, if we would like, of 0.5 meter. That's especially handy if you have other shape, like a T shape or different thickness of slabs. And via this button, you can put them again at the normal. Also, you can, of course, look at the reinforcement, the supports, the loads, etc. You don't need to change anything in the mesh tab. So then we go to the analyze setup. And you make a new analysis and you say, add a comment, a checking design, and you will get this one. And then here you can add the normative loading, check on normative loading, and then you get this one. And if we edit it, you will see it loads, your representativity factors, and the combination of envelopes. And in this case, we just, do the ULESS state, and the ULESS state will be 1.2 on the permanent loads if they are unfavorable, and 1.5 on those Q loads, those variable loads of 10 kilonewton per square meter. So we have chosen for consequent class 2 in this case. Diana will execute a linear analysis. You don't have to do anything with the settings. And we can add the output we needed. And we only need to require the reinforcement, but I added also the applied reinforcement and the required over applied. And the combined reinforcement forces to see the forces in the grids. Then we can run the solver via this button, and we go to the results. In the model data, you can show the reinforcement you added, you did choose in your model, so we did. And in the combination of envelopes, you can see the required reinforcement in the X and the Y direction. So if we choose the X direction, because that's the span direction, we see we need at 1.69 E minus 3 meter. If we put it on millimeters, then we have 1.69 millimeter per millimeter, so 1690 square millimeter per meter. That's needed here at the support, that's the red area. And if we look at the bottom side, then we turn off the top. And then the legend is changed to 1440 for the bottom side. So in this way, you see the required reinforcement, and you can choose your own grid and or bars in your model and recalculate and check it for the second phase. We will do that. And also, you can output the combined reinforcement as an extra. And the reinforcement moments, with including the spread, that's in kilonewton, kilonewton meter, around 300 for the top. And for the bottom, around 270. Yeah. So this concludes the first part of the session, where we have the required reinforcement and we can choose the grids. I will go back to my presentation now. Because then we go into the second phase. We will add the reinforcement as a normal reinforcement and not a design. That's the first step we have to do. And now both grids and bars are taken into account, and you can have as many grids and bars as you like in your model. Also, total strain materials can be used to calculate the capacity. I will show that later. That's, for instance, useful when you have steel fiber reinforcement. Also, you can have an extra load, like a pre-stress load, in your model. That will be taken into account in your evaluation. You can also have extra selection for output results now in the second phase, where you can show deflection. You can show your crack width and the crack spacing. For the ULESS, you can see the capacities of the for the bending moments and the shear forces, and also the unit checks on both, because you have an acting bending moment. And from the input of your grids and bars, you also have a capacity of your bending moment. So the ratio will be the unit check. So the changes to the model now are that we will no longer consider the reinforcement grid as a design, but as a real equivalent plate in this case, if we talk about grids, and a real bar if we talk about the bars. So what we did for this model is choose a bottom reinforcement, a basis for a top reinforcement, and an extra grid over the support where the high Hawking moment was occurring. And on the other support, to show that it's possible, we did the same amount of reinforcement for the grid, but then added it as bars. I will come to the size of the bars and the grids later in the, when I go to the model. And in this phase, we can then check it for the bending moments and the shear forces, as I will show. So then, parallel sidestep about the total strain curves. In this second design, we can choose the Eurocode procedure, where we only have tension forces in the steel and no tension in the concrete. Or we can choose the total strain curves, and then we can use also tension in the concrete. The Model Code 2010 allows nowadays already to calculate the behavior of steel fiber in the concrete. And the next Eurocode version also will most probably have a chapter about steel fibers. What is the essence of the steel fibers? It will increase the capacity of the concrete after cracking of the concrete. So the post-cracking behavior. If we would look at normal plain concrete, which will crack, for instance, at 3.5 MPa, as can be seen in this graph, we have a certain energy, not too much under the graph, and the crack will open very easily. If we add steel fibers, the steel fibers will start to work when the concrete cracks, and they will continue working if the crack gets more wide, and according to the model code, it is allowed to take the action of the steel fibers into account up to a crack width of 2.5 mm. In reality, if you perform real tests, the effect of steel fibers is taken into account much longer than 2.5 mm. If we combine the two effects, so the plain concrete and the action of the steel fiber, we end up with this red curve, which has a higher energy under the graph if you look at the stress crack mouth opening or a stress strain diagram, allowing more resistance by the concrete. In Indiana, we have a special stress strain curve made for the steel fiber material. It is based on the Hordijk energy for plain concrete combining with the steel fiber. In a later e-learning session, we come to it in more in detail, but the input is as follows. You can input this number of points on the diagram for the stress strain or stress crack mouth opening. Steel fibers are most of the time input as a stress crack mouth opening in reality by the engineers, because they get the crack mouth opening via tests done on small specimens. But from the model code, you can also choose a certain class. And based on the concrete class, we have a tensile strength. We have an FTS based on the specimen test for the steel fiber. Every steel fiber supplier can tell you this value, that's the FR1, and they can also tell you the FR3 value, that's this one. And based on these two and the Hordijk curve, we will set up the Diana model for the uniaxial tensile strain, as can be seen here. That means that we always have a drop of the tensile strain before the FL1. From the bending test of the specimen, it can be hardening, but in uniaxial tension, it is softening. More background information can be found in our manual at the chapter analysis and then 68 design checking analysis. I will show that when I go back to Diana for the second phase model. So now we go to the second phase. We have an AS required. We add the bottom top reinforcement and we're going to check the crack width, the unit check on shear and the unit check on the bending moment. Now I'll stop my presentation again and let's go to the checking model. The bottom reinforcement first, if we show the material of the bottom reinforcement, we don't need to change anything. It's just the same. We have the linear elastic material still. If we go to the bottom reinforcement geometry, we have to change something because now this checkbox should be unchecked because we don't want to consider it in design anymore as A is required, but we would like to consider it as real bars. So in this case, the bottom reinforcement will be, I will put it in millimeters, a bar 20 millimeter every 150 millimeter spacing that is chosen. So 20, 150, and in the Y direction, less important in this model, because in Y direction, there's not too much moment, of course, there is also chosen something. Then we also have a reinforcement at the top. We choose there bar 10 at the spacing 150 as a basis all over the model in the top, and then especially at the support over there and the second support, we will add extra top reinforcement, namely the extra top reinforcement that will be 16 every 150 in X direction and nothing specified in the Y direction. So this grid has only an equivalent thickness in this direction and zero in the Y direction because we don't need it. And then for the bars, edit. We have chosen the same bar diameter, of course, as in the grid. And then we added the distance between the bars, probably as 150. Let's check it by the measuring tool and choose this. And then at the bottom, you can see in the right bottom of your screen in 10.4, you can see the distance of your measurement. So that's a change to 10.3. Then you saw the pop-up box, but now you can always see it in the bottom of your screen. So with this reinforcement, we're going to set up the analysis, the normative loading, and now we can set up the normative loading for the S-less and the U-less. We still have the same loads, and we would like to have all the load combinations again, but now we have two combination types. The first one, still 0.9 for favorable permanent loads, and the rest one for the S-less. And we have a second envelope where we have the permanent loads times 1.2 and the variable loads times 1.5 for the U-less. You can later change also these names to S-less and U-less for your own convenience. And then the output of results, we can add some output of results. Because now we would like to see the shear force design capacity and the unit check on that. And we would like to see the ultimate bending moments capacity and also the unit check for that. For the SLS, we would like to see the crack width and we would like to see the distance between the cracks. And later for the normative, we would like to see the normative variable load to go on for the nonlinear analysis. So we would like to know which load combination is responsible for a certain maximum bending moment or crack width, etc. Then we can calculate and we can go to the output. Now we have in the model data more information. We have the capacity of the model in sense of the capacity on the let's go to kilonewtons in this case, the capacity on the structure. For the supports we have 355 kilonewton capacity, and in the bottom we have around 400, is that true? Yeah. And the shear capacity in kilonewtons per millimeter, let's go to kilonewtons per meter, we have around 200 kilonewton near the supports. And without the extra reinforcement, we have around 189 kilonewton at the other side. That's the model data. Of course, we also have acting bending moments and shear forces in the SLS and in the ULS. So first check the SLS for the crack width. We go to the SLS and we can see the maximum crack width in the SLS phase. The plus is on top again. We will put it on millimeters. So we have 0.8 millimeters. By this button, you can turn off your elements. 0.28 millimeter on the top. And in the bottom, we have 21.21 millimeter. So if we would say that the value to check is 0.3, then this is okay. We can also look at the distance between the cracks in the top, between 200 millimeter and 350 millimeter. So where we add more reinforcement, we will have less crack spacing, of course. And in the bottom, it is 264 millimeter, more or less. Basically, this is the output we need for the SLS. Here we also have unit check on shear forces and bending, but we don't look at them because we go now to the ULS for checking the bending moments and the shear forces. So then the crack widths are not that important anymore. You can also see you go over the 0.3. We don't do that. We look at the XZ shear forces, so in the Z direction on the X plane. And we see the maximum unit check 0.92 near the supports. So in this case, we do not need stirrups in the plate. The plate apparently is thick enough to take up the shear force. Then we will look at the bending moments, the hocking moments. The unit check is 0.92 on the support. And for the span area in the bottom, the unit check is 0.67. It's not that high because we added quite some reinforcement in the bottom. Eh? If you remembered, it was 20 every 150. So it seems in the bottom we have a rest capacity of around 30%. And in the top, well, the structure seems to be rather on the edge with 8% rest capacity. Then we also have the normative loading. For the Q, We don't look at it now because we didn't need any stirrups. Let's look at the, I have to turn on, off the reinforcements. Let's look at the positive moment. And then you can see the blue ones, they have a value. So these two are loaded. And then we get the maximum positive bending moment here. And for the negative moment in the span area, probably these two are red. So let's put it in the same color. These two are blue with an external force on them specified. So if you load the outer two, then you get the maximum negative moment. Well, with this, you can go on to a nonlinear analysis, which cannot be done in a lot of other packages. And we can show the robustness of this structure, but also how does it fail and where does it fail. Let's go to the PowerPoint again. So we saw the positive bending moment unit check of 0.92 and the negative bending moment 0.67. So we choose this load scenario for the nonlinear analysis. Then we have to add also behavior of concrete and steel after the cracking or the yielding. So for the concrete, we choose conservative brittle material with a concrete strength and then low after energy, after peak, and a compressive strength of 20 MPa and an ultimate strain of 3.5 per mil. No increase in confinement to be on the conservative side. Then for the yield of the steel, we will add a plastic strain with a yield stress. It will yield at 435 MPa, have some hardening of 6% as stated in the material code, up to 457 MPa, and then it will drop to zero, having no energy at all. We will need to adapt the analysis settings and do that as a load scenario. So the load scenario is first dead weight up to 1. Geometry load combination dead weight is 1, and we add just 1. Then we add the Q load up to 1, and we have the SLS state. Furthermore, we go to the ULS state where we add the permanent load up to 1.2, and then we add the Q load again up to 1.5. And then we do an extra step where we will increase the load combination 2. So that is span 1 and span 2, the Hawking moment. And we will increase it with infinitive step, let's say 50 steps, or you can have 100 steps with an arc length control. So it will reduce step size when it's needed. And you can also add, if you would like, somewhere a stop load on a certain point and switch off the arc length method at the last step. Basically, this is the preferred way if you would go through these steps. So you have load steps where you have infinitive load steps, including arc length, and then you let it stop via the total load of, for instance, 1.2 for permanent or 1.5 for the distributed load, where you switch off arc length at the last step. Then it will nicely come to the value specified. Then we go to the nonlinear model. The nonlinear model is probably this one. Yeah. So we changed the material, we added all these steps, and we calculated the model. And let's look at the ULS step. The ULS step of 1.5, and we see this deflection for the SLS state, we see now 0.23 as a bottom crack. And if we go to the maximum of the layers, we see it on top just over the 0.33. So the SLS seemed to be a bit progressive, and the nonlinear gives a bit more crack width, but with the bars, seems to be okay. For the EULA state, we can check in a nonlinear analysis first the concrete stress and the concrete strain, because when it goes over the compressive stress, then we go to the concrete compressive strain to check. So the stress in the concrete is negative, so we go for the minimum, and we see it's only 11 MPa, where we specify 20 as a maximum, so that is no problem. And you can also see that on the strain that it's lower than 3.5 promille. The second thing to check in a nonlinear analysis would be the reinforcement stresses. Reinforcement stresses seem to be 380, so still no yielding yet, so we also don't need to check the strains. And then we can go on, keep on loading, and we see the load is increasing and increasing. And it's possible in this case, with these assumptions that are conservative, to apply a load of around 3.16. And then it drops, something happens. Let's see what happens just before the peak. Now, we can see already the strain in the reinforcement is 2.5%. And it was the maximum. So apparently in this step, the 2.5% is reached, and the Hawking moment cannot be taken up anymore. We can also see that from, the reinforcement stresses, it's really yielding. And we can look at the concrete. And we see the concrete can take still a bit. It is at 3.3 promille, so it's almost crushing. So apparently, the amount of reinforcement is not enough to take more than twice the load of the ULS case. What can we see more is that we have redistribution of the stresses. If we look at the ULS load in the nonlinear analysis, and we look for the positive moment and the negative moment, we see a ratio of 1.32. So the positive moment being here around 300 kilonewton, and the negative moment being in the mid of the field span of 230 kilonewtons. And if we load it to failure, into failure of 3.16 times the load, then we see that only 77 kilonewton is added, kilonewton meter is added to the support, and a lot more is added to the reinforcement bottom, because we had a larger reinforcement in the bottom. And then the ratio changes to only 0.95. So in this failure, load failure step, the bottom reinforcement gets much more load relative to the support with respect to the ULS state. So that's a redistribution of stresses to the field area, to the span area. To conclude the this e-learning session, it's almost time also, we did the following. We first did a design analysis and we checked the reinforcement needed via a left arm between the reinforcement and the other side of the concrete of 0.9 times the height. We gathered AS required. Then we added reinforcement in grids and bars, and we checked the linear load distribution, but now with an enhanced nonlinear cross-section analysis. So the cross-section capacity is calculated nonlinear already in this phase. Then the third step was the nonlinear analysis to see what is the rest capacity, what is the robustness, and how does it fail. And it turned out that the capacity ratio is shifting from the support to this midspan area. And this model with these assumptions has a robustness factor of around a factor of 2, namely the load factor of 1.5 in ULS and the ultimate load factor. An overview of the findings can be seen here, where we have the design required reinforcement in the positive Hocking moment and the negative span area, the choice of the reinforcement in the second phase analysis, the unity check with that reinforcement, and then the bending moments at ULS state and the failure state. So I thank you for attending to this session, this first e-learning session. I hope you gathered a lot of information. I see there are some questions and we tried already on the fly to answer them, but let's go to some questions.
So thank you everyone and have a very good day.